We have more than a dozen active battlefronts, and we are losing nearly every one.
Let's take a small squad behind enemy lines. If we're going to find intel, it'll be there. What squad are we taking in? Clone Force 99. They call themselves the Bad Batch. These guys are clones?
The cavalry has arrived!
The defective clones with desirable mutations. Let's get to work.
Remember, this is a stealth mission.
So much for stealth. I don't like the look of this. This is a trap.
They don't stand a chance.
We're going down!
Let's finish what we started.
Hey guys, how you doing today? Hope you're having a good day so far. So today we're going to cover 10 interesting facts about the clone troopers. Let's start. Number 1. The clone troopers template. Why was it Jango Fett? Now there's no denying that the bounty hunter, and then later his unaltered clone Boba Fett, were among the most dangerous beings in the galaxy. So, having the thousands of duplicates of such a fighter for an army made a lot of sense. Of course, Jango was also a man with a strong sense of independence and high aggression. In other words, someone who would make the perfect warrior, but would be difficult to control. So, the Kaminoan cloners had to find the right balance between retaining his skills, adaptability, and initiative, but still have an obedient soldier that never questioned orders, which they succeeded brilliantly at, ultimately to the Jedi's downfall. Number 2. Why clones? Why didn't Sifo-Dyas commission a droid army for the Republic? Why clones? Well, as advanced as a droid can be built, it still can't yet reach true sentience like a living being. So an army of human clones would be able to think and act in a different and more flexible way than any machine. In addition to that, the Grand Army of the Republic was not simply composed of identical genetic copies of Jango Fett. No. The clones' genes had been modified. The Kaminoans were of course very careful to make sure they kept the best part of Jango's DNA. All of them. In their clones. But they also manipulated and altered other aspects of his genes in order to make an even superior soldier. Number 3. Accelerated aging. Since Jedi Master Sifo-Dyas knew that a galaxy-wide war was coming soon, it was important to create a massive army quickly. Therefore, the clones' growth was sped up. In Attack of the Clones, when Obi-Wan Kenobi traveled to the ocean world of Kamino and visited the cloning facility, he learned that Jango Fett's clones' genetic code had been altered, so that they would grow at twice the birth rate of human beings. This accelerated growth is what allowed the army to be ready for the civil war between the Republic and Separatists. Though proved successful in the Clone Wars, when the Republic transitioned into the Galactic Empire, the practice of cloning soldiers soon came to an end. As much as many Imperial officers saw the appeal in training obedient soldiers from birth, the clones' accelerated growth also meant their bodies would start to deteriorate earlier than regular birth soldiers. Their life expectancy was only around 50 human years at best, so to avoid those issues, the Empire began recruiting natural birth beings to be their stormtroopers. Their natural growth rate made them more durable, and Palpatine wanted mass numbers. It was easier to recruit than to just clone. Number 4. Built to be obedient. The Kaminoans modified Jango Fett's genetic code in order to make the clones more obedient, less independent and aggressive. As Kamino's Prime Minister Lama Su explained to Obi-Wan when he was given that tour of the cloning facilities in Episode 2, the clones were made to obey orders without question and be totally obedient to the Republic, and this became more and more clear as Kenobi saw lines upon lines of clones getting ready to deploy, while others with the utmost discipline sat in endless rows, eating. Even the preteen versions of the clones remained at complete attention as they received instructions from their superiors. Number 5. The clones owe their existence to Sifo-Dyas. How was the clone army ready just when the Republic needed it? Well, we have Jedi Master Sifo-Dyas to thank for that. He was very proficient in all the standard Jedi Force abilities, but he was especially gifted with precognitive Force visions and therefore foresaw the rise of the dark side and the coming war. The Jedi Master decided in secret to commission the creation of the clone army. But with his thoughts always in the future, Sifo didn't notice that right in front of him, His friend and ally, Count Dooku, had fallen to that very darkness he was trying to protect the galaxy from. Ultimately, Dooku arranged for Sifo's assassination, and after the Jedi Master's death, the Count and his Sith Master, Darth Sidious, took control of the clones and arranged for Jango Fett to become the template and added the Order 66 directive to the clones' inhibitor chips. Initially, Sifo-Dyas had intended those chips to be a safeguard against treacherous orders given to the clones. Instead, they became the source of them. Number 6. The inhibitor chips. What exactly were the inhibitor chips that had been installed in the clones' heads? Sifo-Dyas had meant them to be used as a safety measure, but they were repurposed to serve the Sith. The Kaminoans believed the chips were designed to control the soldiers, while also functioning as an extra check, along with the clone's genetic modification, to balance out the unpredictability and aggressive traits inherited in the clones from Jango Fett. The clones were as much in the dark as the Jedi were about Order 66, until the moment it was issued and their chips took control, causing the troopers to turn their blasters on their Jedi generals, ending the Order for decades to come. Number 7. They were allowed to think creatively. Though genetically altered to be less aggressive and more obedient, the clones were actually capable of creative thinking. As was pointed out before, it was that creative thinking that made them superior to the battle droids. The clones were genetically identical, but they also demonstrated separate talents and aptitudes in their ability as soldiers, along with very distinct and individualized personalities from each other, such as CT-T567, or as we might know him, Captain Rex. He demonstrated a strong preference for leadership and had great empathy for the soldiers under his command. In fact, the clone troopers showed more individuality than the stormtroopers that replaced them, as their armor was more distinct with colored markings and they were more free to express their personalities, regardless of their strict conditioning. Number 8. Was it moral to create a clone army? Clone army of genetically engineered soldiers clearly proved to be superior to the military of the Separatist droid army, but they were still human beings, and even they had been grown in a lab. These clones were essentially born into servitude, with no choice but to fight and give their short lives for the Republic, and very few of the clones, or the Jedi for that matter, questioned or expressed disdain for their situation. In the clones' case, this was probably a result of their genetic conditioning, yet there still was a few who objected to their conscription into the Grand Army of the Republic. But except for a few voices of protest, not many in the galaxy questioned the morality of creating a clone army. Number 9. Some clones questioned their purpose. The Kaminoans were pleased with themselves for how they had been able to maintain a balance between having a mindless obedient drone and an adaptable thinking soldier in their clones. However, that didn't mean that that balance was always perfectly attuned in every soldier. Sometimes the cloning process skewed the balance in one direction, more than the other, so some clones were more fanatic while others showed too much creative thinking. And not all of the more free thinkers were quite as loyal to the Republic or the Jedi as they were supposed to be. Such as the case with Cut, who was among the first batch of clones at the Battle of Geonosis. His transport was attacked and he barely survived. Fearing that there would be no way he could survive if he remained in the army, he deserted then and there. Eventually, he settled down with a wife and two adopted kids on the planet Seleucami. Then, there was Clone Sergeant Slick, who had come to believe that the Jedi used him and his clone brothers as their own personal slave army. So when Asajj Ventress offered him credits and his freedom from the Republic if he helped her, the sergeant gave Dooku's agent all the information on the Jedi that he knew. Number 10. The clones served in the Empire. When the Empire rose, the clones weren't immediately replaced by stormtroopers. Not at all. In fact, the clones continued to play an important role for the Imperials, and they were only gradually phased out of service. The clones were highly regarded for the important role they had played in forming the Empire. So, often former frontline experienced clone troopers were used as instructors to the new generation of natural-born stormtroopers. This reflects back to how the clone troopers were trained themselves at the Kamino cloning facility by the Republic. Fully grown adult clones with combat experience would train their newly created batch cadets from childhood until they were combat ready. Well, that sums up these 10 interesting facts. I hope you enjoyed this video. Let me know if you want me to do another 10 interesting facts about clone trooper armor or weaponry or personalities, or maybe even rankings. Thanks for taking the time to watch this video, and I'll see you in the next one. Until then, remember, the Force will be with you. Always.
Now, fulfill your destiny.